You're watching Scottish television. And now Prince Charles returns to the remote Hebridean island of Burnery, which he first visited in secret in 1987. Selina Scott presents this portrait of a prince among islands.
This is the island of Burnery in the Sound of Harris in the Outer Hebrides. For a few days in May 1987, this remote little islet, 3 miles wide by a couple of miles long, became the focus of worldwide attention for the first time in its 3,000-year recorded history. For Burnery, a kind of Gaelic-speaking Shangri-La, if you believe the media, had played host to the future King of Britain. In fact, Prince Charles had come to visit old friends, to plant a few potatoes, to do a bit of fishing, and doubtless down a dram or two. But what caught the imagination of the press and the public was the fact that the local people took the prince at his word when he said he wanted no publicity. And not a whisper of the visit leaked out until the prince was safely off the island. And even when it was all over and the world's press and TV descended waving their checkbooks, no one on Burnery was prepared to reveal exactly what had transpired when a prince came to live amongst them as a crofter. All the local people sought from their future monarch was a promise that one day he'd come back again. Burnery sits like an emerald in the brown ribbon of islands off the Scottish coast that make up the Outer Hebrides. Washed by the waters of the North Atlantic and ringed by the distant mountains of the Uist to the south and Harris to the north, this is indeed a dear green place, a little patch of plenty on the rim of Europe. Burnery was home to a farming people thousands of years before Christ. The Vikings were here in the 11th century. They're said to have dispatched their victims on the island's chairstone before burying the heads here at Crocknan Clargan, the hillock of the skulls. Here too there were savage clearances in the 19th century, but somehow Burnery survived as a community, now much reduced from the 700 souls who once lived and worked here, but still a community whose songs speak of an intense joy to have been born Beandrach, a Burnery person. Burnside Croft is set in 90 acres of mixed arable and grazing land. It's the home of crofter Donald Alec MacKillop, known locally as Splash, and his Australian-born wife, Gloria. In 1987, Burnside was also home for Prince Charles when he came to stay here. One of the older croft houses on the island, it's as solid and unpretentious as the folk of Burnery themselves. This is Ballavanagh Airfield in Benbecula. Just about to land is an aircraft of the Queen's flight, hopefully carrying a very important passenger. In a few moments, we'll find out if the future King of Britain has honoured his promise to the crofters of Burnery. A completely unscheduled royal visit to Burnery is underway, and this time Prince Charles has agreed that I might come along too with a television crew. just as important, the handful of islanders who've been let into the secret have also accepted the intrusive presence of the cameras for this second coming of a prince. What marked the prince's previous trip was the absence of press and TV during the actual visit. But with renewed interest in the Gaelic language and a big increase in Gaelic TV planned, the prince felt television itself could play a part in highlighting the most important aspects of the culture. Last autumn, over 4 years after the original visit, Gloria MacKillop decided to retire from her job as district nursing supervisor. She and Splash planned to extend the old Croft house and do a bit of bed and breakfast. With a healthy Hebridean disrespect for time, they expected the extension to take the best part of a year. Work had just started when the palace called to ask if a certain royal personage could book a long weekend's bed and breakfast. When? In just 6 weeks' time.
Given the secret, but the island kept it. Now, there was very much shorter notice this time. It meant a round table conference with Norman, who was doing the building with John Alec, and we really had to look at this and see whether we could condense into something like 4 or 5 weeks what we were planning to leisurely be doing over the winter months. It's the cooking that worries me a little bit, because we have a lovely new stove. We've had an expert up looking at it, and it's a balanced flue. That rather terrifies me a little.
In fact, the new stove refuses to stay alight, and Gloria can't even confide in the engineer just whose lunch is going to be ruined if he doesn't get it working in time.
Well, the cat likes the bed, Gloria. If no one else, I think it's so firm, isn't it?
Yes. Yes.
Is this what he wanted?
No, there was no special request at all, but it was one. I like the idea of foam beds having nursed the whole of my life and known the terrible problems with sore backs.
We're here on Bernaray, and arriving here just behind me, as you can see, is a small passenger ferry carrying His Royal Highness the Prince of Wales. It'll be the first time he's set foot on the island in 4 years.
Such a long time.
The same evening, the children's Halloween party gets underway, less than 100 yards from Burnside Croft at the local community centre. This is one of the island's biggest nights of the year, and for the next 5 hours, adults and children alike make merry, most of them totally unaware that their future monarch is trying to sleep only yards away. The prince has hardly closed his eyes since flying back from Canada 24 hours earlier. Bernaray's famed West Beach, nearly 3 miles of unbroken sand. Surely one of the few places in his future realm where a jet-lagged prince might go for a walk on an autumn morning with only the storm petrels and me for company. I wondered how hard it was for him to unwind.
I'm not one of those people who gets, I don't think, wound up, if you know what I mean, in the sense of having to unwind again. I find I can, I think, adjust reasonably well to most, I hope, situations. But it is a great contrast, certainly. But very peaceful all the same to be able to come to somewhere like here.
I think it's hard too to pick up threads of relationships you knew 4 years ago and start afresh.
Yes.
But that as much as it is for you.
Yes. But on the other hand, I mean, I do spend my life doing that sort of thing, and I mean, the only problem is trying to remember the names of everybody. I mean, some people I remember more than others. But obviously, Splash McKillop, you can't possibly forget. But of course, I came here. Splash was reminding me, as a child with my sister, when the Royal Yacht Britannia came with our parents. And back in 1956, I think, and we had a picnic on the beach on the other side there. And I can just remember it, actually, because he was saying we played football on the Macca there, which is rather fun.
Well, I've come and joined you this morning on this walk, but normally I hear you get up early and just go off on your own, is that right?
No, not really. I'm not all that good at getting up that early, I promise you. No, but I, the last time I came, of course, I wanted to find out, you know, about the whole way of life, the crofting existence and what part-time farming actually involved, because and the object was to discover, from my point of view, what actually happened. I mean, there is only one way of finding out, and that's to go and do it.
But did you come away feeling as though you had learned something, or did you come away feeling fairly depressed that it's such hard work that how can anyone actually continue making any kind of living out of this place? And the rocks there, the soil's poor.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
As bad sometimes.
Yeah. No, but I do think that it is a way of life. That's the point, I think. I mean, what I sometimes object to is the idea that agriculture is considered as an industry, when in fact it's far more, I think, complex and profound than that. In fact, that farming has a cultural, I believe, and social significance, which is way beyond the ordinary concept of an industry, like any other industry. Mm-hmm. Because when all is said and done, I still believe that people like those who live here and in many of the other communities in the uplands and in the remoter areas of this country are, to all intents and purposes, the backbone of this country.
Mm-hmm.
I believe it most strongly. And they are people who have real values and a care for the land and for their communities, which is essential if we're going to remain, I believe, a civilized nation.
Yes. But well, when you look around you here, and you see the beauty of the place, and you realize then why people in this part of the world don't work, say, as hard.
Yes.
as they do on the east coast of Scotland, or perhaps even further north, when the conditions are just as bad.
You must learn, I suppose, that you have to live with nature. And it's no good trying to push things further than the natural conditions and elements will allow you. So you wait until the conditions are favourable before you can do certain things, which to people living in the south, or maybe even on the east coast, will say, well, they're just being lazy or something. But it's not the case at all, because you understand that there's a natural rhythm that you have to become a part of.
And adapting to the rhythm of life has seen Burnray through good times and bad. Two things supported the island during the hard years, potatoes and kelp. Kelp to make soap and glass for pampered southerners. Potatoes, well, to keep body and soul together. But in the 20th century, sheep and fishing have been the island's mainstay. There's hardly a crofter here who doesn't tend his own flock. And whether it's the lambing, the clipping, or the dipping, Burnray works as a community, with all lending a hand. It's the same sense of community that guides the local boys who work the treacherous inshore waters, creel fishing for prawn, lobster and crab. Burnray looks after its own, on land and at sea. These days, less than 150 people still live on the island, but a decade ago there were fewer still. New bungalows are now appearing among the abandoned black houses of departed generations. But as a fragile self-confidence begins to reassert itself, there are some who believe that the best of the old is being abandoned too lightly. Like the culture itself, the old houses are not yet beyond salvation.
I think it's rather sad not to find a way, with a little bit of imagination and determination, to restore these sort of houses. And I mean, I'm quite convinced it is possible to put damp courses in and things like that, and to make them habitable by modern standards. I personally think that they're such a wonderful feature of these islands, and not only that, but they've got such character and charm, like all, I think, these houses which express the, if you like, the vernacular character of a particular area. It's that's what makes, I think, life worth living in so interesting, when you go around the world and see how everybody has adapted to different conditions in different ways. The variety is infinite.
And here, it's almost as though they've gone all around the island and found the one spot which is really not, it's gale-proof. It's windy over there, it's not so windy here, is it, do you think?
Doing in both senses of the word, it's gale-proof.
Yeah. Should I go first, or should I push you in first?
No, go. Ladies first.
Well, thank you.
It is extraordinary. I find it absolutely amazing they didn't take the furniture.
Oh, look at this little Pembroke table.
Oh, no, it's most extraordinary.
And a fine chest of drawers. Yeah. Lovely furniture. I mean, look, that dresser that's been just left carved.
Well, don't you think the nicest thing of all is that nobody's actually come and taken it?
Yes.
I mean, that's what's so wonderful. Yes. It still belongs.
Yes, you can leave all the doors open, can't you? And this is another thing that everyone tries to get rid of. The moment they move in somewhere, this pine cladding on all the...
It is wonderful stuff. Look at the gas lamp.
This lamp. Can you see that dead sheep through there?
Is there a dead sheep as well?
In the corner, look.
Three dead sheep. They're all coming and look desperate, looking for shelter. You see, most people, tourists and others, people like ourselves, come on the whole usually in the summer. And of course, it's so different in the summer. But to live in the winter in many of these remoter areas is another matter. I think a lot of people, you know, think how wonderfully romantic it would be, but it's very often worse than you think, I think.
This is Sarah, and this is Anna.
Does the back of the world of good?
In the last century, Bernerays supplied its much larger neighbour, Harris, with most of its potatoes. And the island's crop, grown in light, sandy soil and fed still on kelp, as anyone here will tell you, tastes like potatoes nowhere else on earth. Potatoes fit for a prince, in fact, if a prince is fit enough to gather them in.
What sort are they? What variety are they?
This is Scarce Pink.
This is Scarce Pink.
Yes.
But which ones bake best?
Bake best?
Yes. And would you like baked potatoes?
Yes. Yeah. They're all good.
It's funny, the ones that that have the best floury
yes.
insides. I've been doing. These are better ones.
5 years ago, the prince helped plant about 300 mixed trees as part of the island's attempts to create shelter belts for crops.
Now, sir, this is the first ones that you planted. Now, for some reason or other, they haven't done so well, but I think they're still with us.
I haven't got green fingers, that's why.
No, but yeah. I think as long as they look green...
Most of the original trees have succumbed to the Atlantic gales, but the islanders, guided by the Forestry Commission, have planted more.
It's pretty tattered already, this one.
Flags have been planted, along with the new trees, and the tattered remnants are sent back to the Commission, who measure the destructive force of the wind.
And do they send you any information back again?
If I wanted it.
Presumably they come back and say you shouldn't be growing trees there anyway.
This sort of thing, yes. You remember this gentleman?
Yes.
John McKillop.
Nice to see you back here, Highness.
Nice to see you too.
Ian?
Peter here.
There you are. Say hello. That's right. This is the Prince of Wales. This is
Dol Laoghaire's son. All the remains of the Prince of Wales.
All the remains.
It's been a busy day, but there's one more chore before dramming time. It's a dirty job and a wet one, but somebody's got to do it. And in Bernerays, that means everybody.
Not even going to fit in. My splash is turned to go in there.
Sometimes I wouldn't need it.
He's dressed for it.
I'm
pick up the vouchers from participating Shell stations. And collect all kinds of sporting items, including the Guinness Book of Olympic Facts. These are McCain oven chips. Inside every bag, the chips are honed to be healthier chips. Not only are McCain oven chips prepared in sunflower oil, they contain less than half the fat of fried chips, just 5%. So, they're a better chip. And because they're made by McCain, they taste...
great!
McCain Beefeater, Quinkles, or straight-cut oven chips contain only 5% fat, making them healthier chips.
Play the Daily Star Million Dollar Dream Game, and you could become a dollar millionaire. There are also other cash prizes worth thousands of dollars. The Daily Star Million Dollar Dream Game.
Papa?
Nicole!
Some are happy with sheer power. Others prefer more refinement. Happily, you can now have both. the 16-valve Renault Clio.
Just look at him. Bright eyes, a healthy body, a glossy coat, vitality, and strong teeth. See how Pal helps your best friend stay fit five ways.
Solution to indigestion.
Who cares if you can't have that Italian designer dress because of your passion for Italian food? Who cares if your good intentions go to pot because you can't resist desserts? Who cares if popping out for a sandwich means piling on the calories? Who cares enough to come up with Shapers, calorie-counted foods that taste anything but? Who cares?
Say yes to rental. For only $12.99 a month, we'll rent you a 14-inch colour portable TV and video player. It's the ideal bedroom package, and at only $12.99 a month, it's easy to say yes to rental. Glenn's, Hutchison, Robertson's and Stepek, all together better.
Prince has again come to live among them, life for the people of Bernaray goes on much as usual. Shonny Alec McLean, the island's postman, collects the morning mail and sorts it out for delivery. In an island where Gaelic is still the first language, Shonny's duties often include translating the letters as well as delivering them. Bessie Patterson was awarded the British Empire Medal for operating the island's telephone exchange for 25 years. Since she retired, her croft has become Bernaray's newspaper shop. Today, her usual customers collect their papers, delivered with the morning mail. It's Bessie's 79th birthday, and she's heard she might be having a visit from a special birthday guest.
Maybe don't mind this invasion.
Not at all, not at all. No. Oh, you know, this is the man to blame.
No, I'm
sorry.
Hello,
darling.
When
can I go?
Ooh, what's that bird I can hear? Have you got a bird?
Oh, I've got a budgie. I was just going to clean his cage.
But otherwise nothing's changed, I'm glad to see.
Nothing changed. Yeah. Not even though I like no change.
She must be wanting me to do a job for her or something like that.
Yes, especially for you to do here if you finished your house.
When she's paging me.
When can you start? Yeah.
What do you want done?
Oh, lots of things. If I had a man about the house.
This is a wonderful little boy who works down in Gloucestershire for me.
Oh, yes.
He's fantastic. He's a sort of chap who does everything.
Everything.
And can do it all by yesterday.
That's the sort of man I'm looking for, then.
But he's 77, so I don't know.
It doesn't matter, that's all right. I would still be the boss.
Maybe I know. A little bird told me that it's your birthday today. So one or two people have managed to find you a birthday cake. Anyway, many, many congratulations and happy return for the day. Marvellous. I tell you what I was really looking forward to when I came back here, are those dumplings.
Oh, yes.
Who was it who made that delicious one they gave?
I think it was Mary.
Mary, Angus's in the shop, Angus's wife, Mary.
Who's that?
Then
you just have to cut it. Do they cut it straight? And then you just keep going round for the next 6 weeks.
Here we go.
Look at that. Oh, my sin.
Let us see anything.
What about you, Jeff, first? Thank you very much. Thank you.
Close by, Annie MacKillop, Splash's cousin, is out on her croft. She's expecting a parcel of wool to arrive by post, but it hasn't come today. What she doesn't know is just who else is coming today. Annie and her twin sister, Jessie, have over 100 sheep. Once they spun their own wool, but now it comes by post from the neighbouring island of Lewis.
Walking back to
the
sun.
Yeah, this is Annie. Right.
Very nice to see you again. Doesn't seem possible, it's 4 years.
And
it?
Me?
I haven't seen you for ages.
That's right, yes.
I hear you've been wanting him to come and do something to the house.
Yes.
But he hasn't turned back.
Since 4 years.
4 years.
The twins are famed for their fine knitting, and Prince Charles and the Princess of Wales are among their satisfied customers.
I see you're still knitting.
I'll do it.
Still
knitting.
Wonderful.
Why didn't you tell us Prince Charles was coming?
Well...
You answered that once first.
Have been more prepared.
We'll be pleased to
what
see
would you
him
have done
time?
There? What would you have done if he had given you warning?
Oh, collapsed.
While Gaelic is the normal means of expression among islanders of Seanie Alec's generation, the language has declined under the onslaught of anglicisation, especially with the coming of television. And over the years, it was in the dominant English culture that young Gaels discovered a doorway of opportunity through which they could make their way if they fought hard enough. But it's always been an unequal struggle. The marginalised original language of Scotland, now spoken by fewer than 100,000, has had to battle hard to survive against the strongest and most widely spoken language in the world. More robust cultures than Gaelic have failed to make it into the TV age. Prince Charles has always been interested in those parts of the UK he sees as having cultural disadvantages. On a blustery November morning in Burnery, he's also learning about the climatic disadvantages.
Look, I don't mind you, but I have a permanent drip on the end of my nose.
No, bitterly cold wind today, yes.
Now television is being used in the fight to save Gaelic. From next year, £10 million annually is being pumped into more Gaelic language TV programmes.
This is rather nice, all this bit here.
Yeah, they're colourful, aren't they?
And in Burnery, as elsewhere in the Western Isles, the upsurge of interest at primary level is already obvious, with most of the teaching now being supported by Gaelic school texts.
I don't pick Gaelic, I put a Gaelic song here.
Oh, marvellous, yes.
I think we'll run through it.
We all know the words.
Yes.
Obviously, there are many people who say, well, what's the relevance of a language like Gaelic? It's only spoken by, 85,000 people or something on the last count? And what is its relevance to modern, contemporary existence? We all suffer, I think, in many ways from being anchored in the belief that everything is divided into past and future, when in fact, if only we could see things in a slightly more linear fashion, we'd understand that there are very timeless things at stake. This is why I mind about them so much. And I think language is the same thing, because it gives people a sense of belonging, and we all need a sense of belonging and a sense of pride.
and also a sense of a feeling of roots.
According to press reports, you've been learning Gaelic.
No, you know perfectly well you shouldn't believe anything you read in the press. But
it's a hard language, isn't it?
It is.
So you think that £10 million from the government to the Gaelic cause is a good idea, that it should be supported?
Yes, I think it's a wonderful idea. And I'm sure there are people who think that the £10 million could be spent in other ways. And of course, any amount of money could be spent in any number of different ways, obviously. Television can be a very effective medium in this sense, in helping to keep the language as a living entity.
As Prince of Wales, of course, you know the effect that S4C has had on the Welsh language and culture. But 500,000 Welsh speakers, as opposed to 85,000 Gaelic speakers, some people might say, just why bother at all?
But then why bother with a lot of other things? I mean, why bother with opera, for instance, or ballet, or even to a certain extent some classical music, or concerts, because a relatively small minority of people apparently are interested in these things. There are any number of reasons, I think, for keeping things going, even though there may be small numbers of people involved, because they represent something special in our human experience. They're such jolly people, they're so friendly and special like that, and they exude a retiring, shy kind of happiness. It's a remarkable feeling which you get, I think, when you come here. It's unlike anywhere else, really.
What more can a body ask for?
The tunes have got such a special element to them, which is unlike anything else. You could only be here, I think, to hear that sort of thing. And of course, in the Western Isles, they really do hear the truly traditional, ancient ones.
Oh, dance with the dolly, with the whole ale talking, violinist keep a knocking, and a toast keep a rocking. Dance with the dolly, with the hole in the stocking, dance by the light of the moon.
Oh, I'd never say no. Best thing ever.
Just put it on.
This is Mary Smead.
Oh, thank you very much.
Why should I say no? Thank you.
I don't think I've ever heard you say no.
No.
I'll try and recite my bit of poetry. And the poetry comes from a play about Cyrano de Bergerac, you know, the man who had the long nose. I thought of learning it in French, and then I thought, just to spite you, because I can't understand a word you're saying. But then I thought it might take me even longer to learn. And it is actually quite funny in English, if I can remember it. The pure descriptive, from its size and shape, I'd say it was a rock, a bluff, a cape, no, a peninsula. The truculent, you a smoker. I suppose the fumes gush fiercely from that nose, and people think a chimney is on fire. Emphatic, no fierce wind from near or far, save the mistral, can give that nose guitar. Rustic, nay, George, that's no nose. Why, that's a giant turnip, or a midget marrow. Let's dig it up and load it on a barrel. Yeah, that's as far as I've got. But it goes on and on and on. Anyway, I was taught this by my grandmother, which is it's very short, and it goes, Auntie Mary had a canary, whistled the cock of the north. She whistled for hours and frightened the bowers and won the Victoria Cross.
Lysku prætje vale, skleg reiknen stad, bí mæk nýja sjúlgu dag í mograi, spýtar af ennum er ennum húsin gafla, kem hala í
kæmla. Það sé kutjað flikur fæltu er af sjúlu, bygg na mór, art na jösel, kipi ætti sa virsjöf, að hafa kæntar en hér af þessu. A ha chin island bjarnar ei blúher uis te tua.
Stoppel hoach go chravore.
The only sounds heard in this church are human, with a presenter rather than an organ to guide the singing. This is a faith stripped to its bare essentials, but the greatest cathedrals of the land could house no deeper sense of worship. Now there's only one church in Bernaré. Once there were three, with islanders from nearby Pabay swelling the local flock. But Pabay's long been abandoned to the sheep. Might the faith and the Gaelic tongue of Bernaré one day be stilled as well?
Hasinirukus hokus nehilan nier agus the Gaelto sentiro Gaelic man arcanan haheror an ochus gimi pio urson emich priod sasinikui koropui leis kachtunia agus puyum a hastrikus an hanan a chamal pio agus gimi Gaelic Na canan bio, gwtiere gyn hw. Sgedda se sy'n ar dochus, agos ar gwyau o sian y gali. Chadili sacin, yn hachyr sian. A chais ys tynt ac yr ysio. Mari sos gael glor ffwr, y nefiannu, gwtiere gyn hw. Sos gael glor ffwr, y nefiannu. Bunant yn hasht, brih yn hasht, bwy yn hasht. Amen.
That particular timbre to the voice is unlike anything else, I think. It has... extraordinarily ancient echoes, and also to me is so like the sound of the pipes, the bagpipes, with the human voice somehow mimicking the sound of the pipes and vice versa. But it's a very peculiarly Gaelic sound, and I find it deeply moving. It's a wonderful sound.
Nishkro kras ar tiurnia sa krias. Krag siur ye an ahir. Agus go chobun an spirit nai. Mali rai nyule. Svi ura lukkar krai. On am sio mach. Agus go praag. Amen.
He must be frozen in your shirt. Yeah. Didn't get too wet. You've survived the other day's invasion, all right?
Yes.
You're the best dumpling maker on the island.
Yeah, indeed. Yes, I went that way.
In recent years, Angus MacCaskill has seen a welcome revival in the fishing. Things have improved even in the 5 years since the Prince of Wales last joined Angus on a trip on the Bernaré Isle. Velvet crabs, once thrown away, are now fetching big prices on the continent. But today, Angus and his nephew, Ruddy Shaw, are hoping for a tastier dish than crabs to set before a prince.
Lobsters are very hard to come by now, yes. They're getting scarcer every year. But we're quite pleased with the velvet crab now. The Spaniards buy them, so...
But is this a new market suddenly?
For us, yes. 2-3 years ago, they started, and we thought it was ridiculous because we used to throw them over the side.
Where do they go from Bernard? Do you sell them to somebody?
Yes, we are selling yesterday morning. We sell them to a fish salesman.
And he makes much more money than you do, presumably.
Well, good luck to him. Good luck to him.
Yes, I know.
It's rare for any single issue to affect Bernaray's sense of community. But recently, the possibility of linking the island to the neighbouring Uists by a causeway carrying a road has forced Bernaray to think hard about remaining an island. In recent years, apart from the passenger ferry, Bernaray's also had a car ferry. And not all agree a causeway is the only effective way of guaranteeing the island's future.
Clearly, a causeway is going to provide a great deal of the conveniences of life which are not there at the moment. But at the same time, there are clearly going to be disadvantages in that this island existence has that quality which is obviously something of great value to people who may be experiencing, you know, a much more stressed existence. Speed of modern life and everything else doesn't suit everybody. So obviously there are short-term benefits and gains, but in the long term, are not the grandchildren or the great-grandchildren of those who live here going to perhaps regret a causeway? I don't know. I'm one of those sort of people who takes even apparently honorific titles rather seriously. And one of the titles I have always liked is the Lord of the Isles, partly because I'm an incurable romantic. And it is a marvelously romantic title. Also because, I mean, I always have had a soft spot for Scotland. I love painting and I like walking and so on, but there are lots of other places I can do that as well. But it's being part, even for a short time, with a community like this, which for me, is Lord of the Isles, is part of my role as far as I see it.
Ultimately, the way of life of this remote part of the United Kingdom can only survive if its young people especially can be convinced that their distinctive language and culture still has relevance in an age of mass communications and seductive imagery from elsewhere. But the heir to the throne sees equal dangers in exposing the qualities of an island like Bernaray to people in the more overcrowded parts of Britain.
I remember Lawrence Vanderpost telling me when he made a film about the Kalahari Desert, and in particular these remarkable hills where they had these paintings on rock faces of, you know, ancient hunter-gatherers. He told me when he made this film, and he made the films precisely to try and keep the Kalahari special and to save the Bushman culture, the Bushman language. And he told me, apparently with tears in his eyes, that in fact all that had happened is it had been a terrific interest in the whole place. More and more tourists had gone. And it had actually almost destroyed what he'd set out to save.
It's a risk the prince and the islanders chose to take to promote the Gaelic language and culture. But the people of Bernaray know ultimately it's they who will have to live with the consequences of that decision.